Right, you all have a seat. But children, as you go, would you turn and wave at everybody? You guys are so cute, good-looking, good-today kids. Turn around and wave at everybody as you go. Give it up for these kids and the workers. So glad you're here today. We are blessed to have a bunch of kiddos, a bunch of workers that love these kiddos like crazy. It is a beautiful thing. Easter. This story's been going on for a long time, over 2,000 years. So there's no pressure on me as a preacher today to give you something brand new in the middle of a 2,000-year-old story, right? I mean, like, some of you have been around church. You've heard it every way. It's been fricasseed, fried, scrambled, diced, chunked. You've had it all different kinds of ways. And we'll see. But I'm not really trying to impress you with the story today because you kind of know the story. But I'll go ahead and tell you what I'm trying to sell you today. This is what I'm trying to sell you. I'm trying to sell you on a belief, on a faith, on a trust, on a hope, on betting your life, on the good news that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, died, was buried, and that he rose again on the first day of Easter. That's what I'm trying to sell you on. Because if I can sell you on that, then I have this great hope that all of the promises that God wants to give you through Jesus will come alive in your life. So that's where I'm going. Now, I know for some of you, you're like, oh, doggone it. I'm just here because I wanted to have lunch, and they told me I didn't get to eat if I didn't go to church. Right? I mean, it's okay. I mean, I get it. My grandmother, back in the day, back at Calvary Baptist Church in Corbin, Kentucky, my grandmother would always win the Pack a Pew Award. Now, we had pews, wooden pews. You know what I'm talking about? And so Granny had a lot of children. I don't know how many of them there were. There was a bunch, seven, eight. I don't know. I should know how many aunts and uncles I have, right? I don't. I'd have to think for a while. But I have a lot of cousins, like beyond number almost. And so the word would get around that Granny expected everybody to be at church on Easter Sunday morning. Do you know why? Because it was Pack a Pew Day. And if you won the Pack a Pew Award, you got a lily. And she intended to get the lily. And if you weren't there, it would be really bad. She would let you know that you were like disinherited from the family. You didn't belong anymore. So this Easter thing became a big thing because it was time to pack a pew because my granny really wanted to make sure that we all knew the good news of Jesus. And the story of this resurrection has been told for over 2,000 years. The most revolutionary moment in the history of the world, I believe, was found on that first Easter Sunday. And I'm going to do my best to take you back through that story you know well. But if you'll join me and just imagine it fresh again, that would be really helpful. If you would go at the story with me as if it's new news to you, that would be really helpful, not only to me, but mostly to you. So for those of you who have been around church your whole life, forget it for just a moment. For those of you who are new here, thank you for coming. Thank you for trusting us. I do hope to bring you to a place where you would say to God, God, I'm willing to give you a try. I'm willing to trust you the best I know how. That's really where I'm headed today. I'm putting it right out there so you know. I can imagine that you may be a little resistant to that, and that would be okay. I won't arm wrestle you. But I believe that you'll find ample reason to believe in the resurrection of the Son of God as we go through this news today. That's my hope. So today I'm going to talk to you about Jesus, the Son of God, raising from the dead. I'm going to talk to you about Tesla automobiles. More specifically, I'm going to talk to you about the Model S. I got corrected last service by our wonderful music person, Mike. Oh, that's what I said, Model 3. He's a car guy. He hated it when I got it wrong last service. He's like, dude, we got to fix that. You are so messed up on that. Okay, so I'll get it right this service. I hope you can help me out a little bit here. We'll make sure we get it right. We'll talk to you a little bit about Tesla. We'll talk to you about new bodies. Talk to you about a resurrection body. Talk to you about some of those things and take you through this amazing story of the first Easter in hopes that we'll find something in that story that will bring hope back to your life again and will give you something to believe in. That's where I want to go. So I'm going to work mostly today from the book of John, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, fourth book of the New Testament, written by an eyewitness of the life of Jesus, written by one who saw Jesus live, perform miracles, do this amazing life, and saw him die. But then more than that, more than seeing him die, he saw him after he was alive again with a brand new resurrection body that was amazing. And we're going to get into that story for just a minute. So if you want to follow along with me, I'm going to be working from John chapter 19, picking up with verse 38 and moving forward from there for a few verses. And this is an amazing story. We pick the story up with Jesus on a cross. Now, Jesus has just died. The Roman centurions who had killed Jesus made sure he was dead. And by the way, the Romans, this wasn't their only crucifixion. In our imagination sometimes, if you've been around the church, you think, oh, the only person to ever die from being hung on a crux was Jesus. Well, it's not true. The Romans had killed thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of people on crosses. So they were really incredibly good at being sure that people that hung on a cross were really dead. And they would make no mistake that this Jesus would be dead on that cross on a Friday afternoon, just before the Jewish Sabbath was supposed to take place. The followers of Christ who wanted to get his body off the cross were very concerned that they needed to get him into the tomb before the beginning of Sabbath, because as a Jew, you couldn't mess with a dead body on Sabbath. You had to be ceremonially clean, and you couldn't be clean if you touched a dead body, and yada, yada. There's a bunch of rules and regulations around that. So they needed to get Jesus off the cross before the Sabbath started. They needed to get him into a tomb and taken care of and squared away. That's where we pick the story up. Verse 38. And then Joseph of Arimathea asked Pilate if he could take Jesus' body away. He was a disciple of Jesus, but he kept it secret because he was afraid of the Judeans. Some of you who have come here today are secret followers of Jesus too. You find good company in Joseph. But when the chips were down with Jesus, he showed up. And maybe that's the story of your life. Maybe you're into a point in your life today where you say, you know what? I'm not going to be secret anymore. I'm not going to hide anymore. I'm really going to admit that I'm a follower of Jesus. I hope that's true for you today. That if you've been in hiding, that you would come out publicly as a follower of Christ today. Pilate gave Joseph permission. So he came and took Jesus' body. Nicodemus came too, the man who at first had visited Jesus by night. You know Nicodemus from the story in John 3, the most famous verse in the Bible. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. Nicodemus was the first one to hear those words, because he came to Jesus and he asked Jesus, what do I have to do to inherit eternal life? Do you remember what Jesus' answer was? You got to be born again. An impossibility even for a religious person to be born again. It was something only God can do. And the reality is, in your life and my life, for us to really get in on the life God has for us, it is a supernatural miracle that only God can do. We got to be born again under the good news of Jesus that we'll dive into more in this moment. Joseph, Nicodemus, brought a concoction of myrrh and aloes, about 100 pounds in weight. They took Jesus' body and wrapped it up in cloths with the spices according to the normal Judean burial custom. You might find it interesting, the last time you heard about Jesus being wrapped in cloths was where? In the manger. What did the wise men bring him? Gold? What? Frankincense and myrrh. Likely in this burial concoction that Joseph and Nicodemus brought were at least frankincense and myrrh. Chances are that was in the spice concoction for the burial of Jesus. Verse 41. There was a garden in the place where he had been crucified. In the garden, there was a new tomb in which nobody had ever been buried. Okay, the garden's mentioned twice in this passage. Garden, think about this for a second. Step We're in the story. Jesus' body's coming down. They're taking him to a new tomb that's in a garden. Where did you first hear about a garden in the Bible? Adam and Eve were in a garden called Eden. Remember the Eden story? Remember what happened? Adam and Eve placed in the garden to be image bearers of the Most High God, to be ones that would represent him on earth, to take care of the earth, to be trustees of the earth. And they didn't get it right, did they? The first round in the garden didn't go so well. So why are we back in a garden again? See what's coming? See what's coming? You see what's coming? Do you get it? You see? The author's telling you, hey, signaling, he's telling you something. Listen, we're back in the garden. We're back in the garden. Remember where we are. We're in the garden. We're in the garden. So, because the tomb was nearby in the garden, because of the Judean day of preparation, they buried Jesus there. That was on Friday. They buried Jesus there. Have you ever been there on a Friday when your hope was buried? Have you ever been in that moment when all hope is gone? There is nothing else to be done. You've done all you can do, and the one you loved is buried, done. You ever been there? Maybe you've come to the end of a marriage painfully, and the marriage is buried and it's done. Maybe you've come to the end of a career too soon, and what you thought was going to be your ticket to a great life has become a dead end, and hope is buried and it's dead. It's Friday. It's Friday. It's hard. Bad. Hope is dead. Hope is buried. Have you ever been there? You ever been on a Friday when hope is lost, when it's gone? Some of you today, if I drilled into your life, if we sat down and had a conversation, you would tell me in some ways it's Friday and all hope is gone. I am hopeless. I got nothing. My hope is dead. What I thought, who I thought was going to save me is dead. You ever been there on Friday? Back in the day, there was this great communicator, a guy named Tony Campolo. Had this amazing talk. And Tony Campolo was a kind of a rotund guy, and he sweated and spat a lot when he spoke. So he would be doing stuff like this. He'd be at the edge of the stage. He'd be spitting all over the people in the front row. And he would move his head like this and he would crazy talk about Jesus and the cross. And he had this great talk. And the talk was called, "It's Friday, but Sunday's coming." And the first three rows got sprayed with spit the whole talk. Sweat flew off of him. And he shared this because of his passionate gospel, because he believed that it's Friday, but Sunday's coming. And he would talk about it, and he would inspire you. And my hope today, that if you don't remember anything else today, you remember this. It's Friday, but Sunday's coming. Imagine that is spat all over you. And you'll get it. You see, it's Friday, but Sunday's coming. And so you got to know this in your heart, in your spirit. No matter how deep and dark and desperate and dead your hope looks, it's Friday, but Sunday's coming. It's good, right? It's good. Can you believe that? Can you buy into that? That it's Friday, but come on now. It's Friday, but let's do it again. It's Friday, but Sunday's coming. Sunday's coming. Yeah, it's good. You see, the Bible leaves us dead-ended right here. They buried Jesus there, and that's it. That's all they say. Really? Thank you so much. I'm left there at the tomb with the dead Jesus. And in tombs in that time, they were above ground. It was a cave of sorts, and they put a stone across the entrance of the tomb of Christ. And they sealed it up, and they placed a guard because they were afraid that Jesus' disciples would try to sneak out and steal the body because Jesus had said that we'd raise again from the dead. Now, I know this not just from the Gospel of John, but from the other writers of Gospels, the story of Jesus. It's Friday. Sunday's coming. Some of us are living in Friday right now. But after Friday, once Jesus is in the grave, once your hope seems gone, maybe the darkest day of all that comes next, which is Saturday. On Saturday, how are you feeling? How are you doing on Saturday? It's hard, isn't it? Dark. It's like the storm has set in and the clouds will never finish raining on your parade. It will never, or on your Easter egg hunt either. And it just rains and it pours and it drives home the grief. And our hope fades even further away. And it seems even more desperate. On Saturday, it's hard. It's hard, but the text doesn't even mention Saturday. It just skips right over it like it doesn't exist. But some of you know what it's like to be in Saturday, don't you? Some of you are in Saturday right now. Some of you have lost something that mattered to you so much or someone that mattered to you so much, and you are in the Saturday mode and hoping and praying for a miracle, for a release, for something to be resolved that would get you to Easter. Because in your heart, you know if it's Friday that Sunday's coming, but to get from Friday to Sunday, you got to go through Saturday, and Saturday is not always easy. So we hang on for Sunday. Chapter 20, verse 1. Easter. On the first day of the week, Sunday, very early, like the 8 o'clock service people, not y'all. Y'all are slackers. Okay. Just kidding. Kinda. No, I really am. On the first day of the week, very early, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb while it was still dark. Now, Mary, as she comes to the tomb, some of the other gospel writers suggest she came with some company. She came with some other ladies. And we all know why the ladies were coming to the tomb on Sunday morning after it had been Sabbath, because you couldn't touch the body or work with the body on Sabbath, so the Jews had to wait. So they waited till that morning, the first chance they could get back to Jesus' body. Why did the women come back to the tomb? Because they knew that the men had messed it up. They knew. They're like, dude, it was two dudes, and they did this burial thing. I can just hear the women. It's Sabbath. They're not supposed to be gossipy and stuff, but I guarantee you they're over in the corner going, Joseph and Nicodemus, they did that. You know that ain't right. We got to get this right. So the women got together early in the morning, and they headed to the tomb because they loved Jesus. And they knew the men hadn't done it right. So they were bringing their own spices. They were bringing their own stuff because they were going to get it right. And by the way, in that early entourage that came to the tomb, as far as the Bible says, there were no men because women don't invite men to do work they know is important. Okay, now how many women will admit that? That in your heart of hearts, you know that you're way better than the men. Go ahead and say it, Ray. Okay, but men... Men, how many of you know it's true? Give me an amen if you know it's true. Amen. That some way, somehow, your wife has signaled to you. You just don't cut it, dude. Like, you poor guy. I mean, they fully believe in the creation story. When God looks at Adam and says, it's not good for him to be alone, all the women are going, yeah, that's right, man. They mess it all up. So it's good that I'm here to take care of it and make it right. So these women are coming to the tomb to make it right. But as they come toward the tomb, other gospel writers tell us they've got this problem on their mind. What's the problem on the mind of Mary as she comes toward the tomb of Christ? The stone. Who's gonna move the stone? Right? Who's going to move the stone? Who's going to take it away? How am I going to get that done? In our lives, sometimes you have a big boulder in your way, don't you? And you wonder, who's going to move the stone? And if I drilled into your life, into your heart today, and we talked, you would tell me, some of you would tell me, I got this giant stone. I don't know how I'm going to move it. I don't know how it's going to go away. My hope seems dead. There's a stone in the way. There's nothing I can do about it. I feel stuck. I can't solve this on my own. What I have here is a whole glass jar full of stones. Now to you, these stones seem tiny, but they are stones. If you were an itty-bitty person, this could be a great big stone, right? Want you to imagine, go with me there for a second. Imagine it's your itty-bitty, and you got this great big stone in your way. But there was a human-sized person coming by, and you could yell up to the stone. This is kind of like Horton Hears a Who kind of thing. Okay, so you say, hey, I got this stone. Could you move the stone? And you, being a nice human, would say, sure. And you would, sorry, Mike, you would move the stone. You would just throw it away. You would just throw the stone. You would just flick it, like right here, if I put this on the Bible. I won't really do it, because, like, yeah, Phos Church, three people went to the emergency room for getting hit by rocks in the worship service. Okay, that'd be a great headline, right? So, this seems so big if you're a tiny, tiny person. But as small as this stone seems to you, how much smaller does your stone seem to God? It is no thing for God to roll the stone away. It is no thing for Him to change the game in your life. It is no thing for Him to move what seems too big for you to move. It is no thing. And so, go back to the text. On the first day of the week, very early, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb while it was still dark. She saw that the stone had been rolled away from the tomb. So she ran off and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one who Jesus loved. They've taken the master out of the tomb, she said. We don't know where they've put him. Now, the stone rolling away wasn't really the miracle, was it? It was a miracle, but it wasn't the miracle. What was the miracle? That Jesus had risen from the dead. Now, not just an ordinary resurrection, not just a resurrection where he was this ghost that just kind of appeared to a few people, but he was actually physical, trans-physical, new kind of body, first fruits of a resurrection, a hope for us. Paul says about Jesus' body, he was the first fruits of a new creation. Did you know that someday you're going to get the same kind of body that Jesus had? Isn't that cool? Isn't that cool? It's amazing. And that body, we can see, later that day, Jesus shows up in a room where the disciples are locked away for fear of persecution. And this body, behind a locked room, behind the locked doors, Jesus appears to them in the middle of the room. Wouldn't you like to be able to do that? Pop in and pop out of where you want to. You get a new kind of body. Someday, at the resurrection, when Jesus Christ comes back and God makes all things right, a new heaven, a new earth appear, you are going to get a new kind of body. It's kind of like the New York Auto Show that's going on right now. Check me out. Check this out. At the New York Auto Show this week, they revealed a new car. It's the fastest production car ever built. Do you know what it's called? There are no car buffs in here. It goes to 0 to 100 and really fast. Like, it goes 0 to 60 in like 2.5 seconds. Is that right? Oh, sorry, 2.8. I was off by 3/10 of a second. Thank you very much. Okay. And it can do a wheelie. This is a sweet ride. I mean, so cool. It's just like the Chevette I had when I graduated from college. When my Chevette died and went to heaven, it hoped to be a demon someday. It's that kind of thing. Like, it's like this new body, this new thing, it just, it's like, oh my gosh, it's all new. It's something totally different. When Jesus' resurrection body was shown to the disciples, it was something they had never seen before. It was the coolest thing ever. How do I know? Because people that were following Jesus, these disciples were once cowards and afraid and shrunk back and drew away from the cross and shrunk back from the trial of Jesus, and they denied they even knew him. But those same people, after experiencing the resurrected Christ, were transformed. They were transformed because of the power of the resurrection of the Son of God, who was not just an apparition, not just a ghost, but was a physical, new kind of body, something like had never been seen before and won't be experienced by us until the resurrection of the dead, when Christ comes back and leads the procession to give you your new body. And I'm telling you, as different as a demon, the Dodge Demon is from a Chevy Chevette, is your body from what you're going to get someday. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. Right? Yeah, give it up. Give it up. Because I promise you this, no matter how much you work out, no matter how many energy bars and fitness bars you eat, no matter how many weights you lift, someday your body will break down. Someday it won't work like it does now. And you will be very frustrated and you will not be happy. It will be hard. They tell me, Mert, that growing old is not for sissies. That's right. That's right. Mert, here on the front row, is one of my favorite people in the whole world. And she is our resident saint. God has refined her over the years into an incredible follower of Jesus. But I think she would be the first to tell you that someday, when she gets that new body, it's going to be magnificent, right? It's going to be incredible what God does in you, for you, and through you. Not just in this lifetime, but in the life to come. So I'm encouraging you to get your sight off the boulder. Get your sight onto the real miracle that someday, somehow, God is going to answer your prayers and things are going to be resolved. When we get that new kind of body, that new kind of thing that's going on in our lives. Now, the stone rolling away, this wasn't the first time the followers of Jesus had seen a stone rolled away. They had seen it before when a good friend of Jesus named Lazarus had died. Remember the story? Some of you do. Jesus was summoned by Mary and Martha to come to Lazarus' side because Lazarus was really sick. But the scriptures tell us that Jesus delayed for 3 days. And in that 3 days, Lazarus had died. And Lazarus had been wrapped and placed in a tomb. By the time Jesus got there, Mary and Martha were so upset. They're like, if you had been here, he wouldn't have died. That's what it feels like in life sometimes, doesn't it? That if Jesus had just shown up, everything would have been okay, but he didn't. He was late. Sometimes you prayed prayers that weren't answered. But on that day, in the heat of the day, as Jesus approached the tomb, the ladies are trying to stop and said, no, you can't open that tomb because he's been dead for 3 days and by now he stinketh. That's King James. And so Jesus ignores them. He said, no, this is for the glory of God. And he says, Lazarus, come out. And guess what happens? Lazarus comes out, right? And all is made well. All that was undone is done again. All that was wrong is made right. So we have two stories of stones being rolled away and things, good things happening. And so I could leave you here with this. I could say, so if you just have faith, then every stone is going to be rolled away. Everything that was once wrong is going to be made right now on this earth the way you want it to be. But would you believe me? Why wouldn't you believe me? Because it's not true. It's not true. I wish it were. I wish that everything we wanted, we got the way we wanted it. I think I do, although sometimes I think, man, if I got everything I wanted, I'd really be a mess. And some things I prayed for, like the high school girlfriend, it's kind of like a country music song. So glad I didn't get her. Lord, have mercy, my life would be a mess. Instead, I got Julie, which was far better. She'll tell you so. Okay. And so, stones run away, people raised from the dead, were 100% so far. But there's this other follower of Jesus, a guy named John the Baptist, who actually was the precursor to Jesus, who told people, hey, Jesus is coming, the Son of God is here, you need to repent, for the kingdom of God is here. He's the greatest person ever. Jesus said about John the Baptist that there has not been a person born to a woman who is greater ever than John the Baptist. So John the Baptist has been sent to prison for challenging the local authorities. He's in prison, and he's getting news that Jesus is doing all this cool stuff. So John sends some of his followers to Jesus, says, Jesus, you know, listen, dude, I'm hanging out in prison. Pretty sure they're going to kill me real soon. So are you the one? Or should we look for somebody else? John's disciples show up near Jesus' side, and they watch him do all these healings and these miracles and these cool things he's doing for people. And finally, there's a break in the action. They're able to come along to Jesus. They said, Jesus, John is in prison, you know, and he wants to know, are you the one? Jesus said, oh, yeah, I'm the one. Go back and tell him all the cool things I've done, all these things you've seen me do. But tell John this. Blessed is the one who doesn't fall away on account of me. And it wasn't long thereafter that John was brought out of his prison cell long enough to behead him. And he died as a prisoner. His prayers weren't answered. The batting average goes down. So what's going on? Why would I bring this up? Here's why. I don't want you leaving here with a faith just in your faith, because that would leave you broken and all alone. I want you to leave here with a faith in God, the Father of Jesus, who was raised from the dead. I want your faith to go further than the limits of what you can hold on to and what you can demand and dictate from God. I want your faith to be built on the sovereignty of God. You know what that means? The sovereignty, you know what that means? That God knows more than we do. He understands your situation more than you do. Sometimes your prayers are not going to get answered. It's okay to pray them. Because I want to elevate your faith. He's a mysterious God. He's a big God. And sometimes the stone gets rolled away and sometimes it doesn't. In which case does he cease to be God? He's God in both cases, right? All the time. All the time. He's still God, and you can still trust him. He's sovereign over the universe. He understands everything. He lives in heaven, the realm of God, which is like this. We live on earth, which is like this. Jesus came to bring those two together. Heaven and earth collide in Jesus. Find your faith there in the Son of God who was raised from the dead. Put your faith in him, not in your faith. Put your faith in God, not in your faith. Put your faith in the one who knows more than you do. And you can live at this intersection of heaven and earth. Whereas Jesus prayed, I want it to be down here like it is up there. That's how we can live, because of the power of Jesus. But I want you to shift from faith in your faith to a faith in Jesus Christ, the Son of the Most High God, who was raised again from the dead, who oversees the entire universe. It doesn't yet appear all the power that's going to be available. We don't have our resurrection bodies yet, but someday you will. You don't have the answers to all of your prayers yet, but someday you will. You may still be stuck in Friday or Saturday, but Sunday's coming. And Sunday might happen in this life, but it for sure will happen in the next. It may be Friday, it may be Saturday, but Sunday's coming. And I'm begging you, asking you fully to place your trust, your faith, your belief in Jesus, the Son of God. Let's talk about faith for a minute, what the Bible calls faith. If I say I have faith in the stool, okay, how would you know that I have faith in the stool? What? I'd sit on it, but what if I just talk about it? I got faith in the stool. I believe in the stool. Hallelujah. Amen. The stool is great. Woo! Would you believe me? Yes or no? I just say stuff about it. Some of you guys are like that about Jesus. You ain't got no faith in Jesus. You say a lot of words about him. You've not staked one thing in your life on Jesus. Today I'm asking you to have faith. The way the Bible talks about it is to put the full weight of your life on Jesus. To bet your bottom dollar on Jesus. That's what I'm asking you to do today. I'm asking you to believe in the Son of the Most High God who was raised on that first Easter with a brand new resurrection kind of body that you can have too someday. Isn't that good news? So today, if you've never taken Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you never trusted Him, would you do that today? The best you know how? Would you come to Him and say, God, I can't do life on my own. I need You. I want the power of Jesus to work in my life, even when the stone doesn't roll away, even when the answers don't come the way I want them to, even when life isn't working out like I thought it should. I know someday it will, God, and have trust and faith in a God who's sovereign and above all, that you can trust Him, that someday your stone's going to roll away. Someday the answer's going to come. Someday it's all going to be made right. And someday God will reign on earth as He does in heaven, and we will all be made right again. And that is the great news of Easter. Isn't that good? Let's pray.